Hello, I am Jane Kinsu Cheng, one of the editors of the Manila Bulletin. Welcome to MB Hot Seat. This is Manila Bulletin's forum where our editors and content producers face the personalities running in the 2022 national elections. For this episode, my fellow panelists joining me are Ma'am Isabel De Leon, senior editor of the Manila Bulletin, Ms. Alyssa Nivera, content producer of the Manila Bulletin, and Mr. Lance Advincula, member of the social media team of the Manila Bulletin. Our guest for today is Mike Defensor, one of the candidates for mayor of Quezon City. Mike, who is currently a congressman representing Anak Kalusugan Party List, has a solid track record of public service. He started at a young age as a councillor of the 3rd District of Quezon City, eventually becoming its representative for 2 terms. He then went on to serve in the executive department under the Arroyo administration. We want to hear from Sir Mike's stand on various issues and his plans for Quezon City, the most populous city in NCR. Please welcome to the MB Hot Seat, Mr. Mike Defensor.
Thank you so much, Jane.
Thank you, sir. Before we start with the questions, may we invite Sir Mike to share a few words to our audience?
Yes, thank you so much to the Manila Bulletin editorial group, including its all the reporters and officers of the Manila Bulletin. Thank you so much for having me and giving me the opportunity para marinig ng ating mga kababayan yung programs and plans natin for Quezon City. So thank you again, once again, and I'm ready to be grilled this morning.
Ready. Yeah, we have Ma'am Isabel to start.
Thank you for accepting our invitation. Sir, lopsided daw yung mayoral race in Metro Manila towards the incumbent and the relatives of the incumbent. Do you agree with this?
I think you're referring, Isabel, dun sa publico's survey. Actually, yung publico survey, immediately I called them up about it because, in fact, supposedly, 2 weeks before that, nagkaroon kami ng arrangement for them to conduct a survey in Quezon City. Kasi kami naman, ako, myself, no, I have my own internal tracking of the survey. And there are other people who are doing their own surveys in Quezon City. I found out that the publico survey is composed of 100 samples. So for the whole Quezon City, isang daan. And usually, di ba, to have a clearer perception of what is happening, yeah, you have about 1,200 baseline minimum to have a good indication of the pulse of the people, it should be 1,800. Secondly, the survey was based on an online survey by a Singapore partner that they have. So parang yun, nagulat na rin ako. And I explained to them, kasi sinabi ko sa kanila, how can it be later on, for example, sabi nila 51-18, something to that effect, or 59-18. Sabi ko, paano, for example, if I jump 30 points and the survey will be 51-48? Hindi naman kapani-paniwala yun because, you know, I've known surveys from time immemorial. Ako mismo pinag-aaralan namin yan during the national elections, local elections. So, yan yung isang problema. I think, well, you know, for a long time, since last year, I've been worried about the surveys because of the face-to-face interviews. Pero itong recently, okay na naman. Nakikita ko pwede naman na talaga that surveys are conducted in a manner that the methodology is acceptable to all of us. So in this particular survey, isang daan niya na samples. I just want to clarify. And well, of course, I respect what Publicus is doing. But honestly, hindi ko naman matanggap na yun yung result.
So you believe na ang lakas ng chance mo na maging next mayor ng Quezon City?
Honestly, I don't want to speak of the surveys kasi baka malaman ng kabila. But of course, we know even before I filed, di ba? Kailangan klaro ka agad kung ano yung chances mo before filing. I just want to, you know, when we had our own tracking, I was already telling Bingbong Crisologo na for him to run again. Because the surveys would show that those who voted for Joy are now changing their minds and want to vote for Bingbong. And even before filing, lamang si Bingbong. Pero ang sabi ni Bingbong, hindi, I'm too old for that, hindi ko na kaya, ikaw na Mike yung tumakbo. Honestly, it would have been easy for me to run for re-election. I'm only on my first term. So that in itself is an indication why I filed. There is a study that we have been conducting, and the study is very good. And also that the four incumbent, kasi yung dalawa, we have six districts, two have already graduated. So it's a new, you have new candidates for the two districts. But for the four incumbents of the four, I have three. And the one running, District 1 is Onyx Crisologo, District 2 is Precious Hipolito Castelo, District 3 is Alan Reyes, and District 4 is Marvin Rillo, who has been a consistent number one counselor in that district.
So what do you think is your edge over the other candidates?
I think sa election, no, in general, malaki ang play ng what we did during the pandemic. Kasi dyan makikita, I think people now, in the coming elections, will be basing your performance on what you did during the pandemic. And both, ako naman, no, modesty aside, in Congress, I was there even when it was not, when we were limited, yung participation namin in Congress. So the Bayanihan 1, Bayanihan 2, yung support for the ayuda that we wanted. Yung pagpapauwi ng OFWs, about 200,000 of them, we were there. During that time, preparation for PhilHealth, we were already working on that kasi di ba nagkaroon ng mga anomalies and we wanted to make sure na yung mga tao talagang mabigyan ng pagkakataon sa PhilHealth. Now, on the one hand also, we organized a group, yung ACAS 1, which is in, now they formed a party list for that. Pero kami, we were the first one to act, giving support to our frontliners. In fact, the first accredited quarantine center was formed by us. Isa lang ako, I'm not the one leading it. I'm one of those who founded it. And we were helping many communities, we were helping the doctors. Kaya nga, even in the hospitals, yung ACAS 1 group is very popular kasi kailangan ng PPE, we're going around as far as Laguna, as far as Bulacan, even to the north, Pangasinan and Baguio. Tumutulong kami during that time na wala pang lumalabas. Kasi talagang, alam mo, initial namin ginawa nun, talagang tumatawag yung mga nurses, doctors, and admin staff, security staff ng mga hospital. They needed food. Kasi lahat sarado. So nagluluto kami, gumagawa ka ng mga pagkain, tumutulong kami. So on both aspects, without thinking of running, talagang ginawa naman namin yung trabaho namin.
Eh, yung cyber libel case naman na final sa yun ni Mayor Joy, how can you tell us something about that?
Okay, nag-file siya sa akin ng 100 counts of cyber libel. In fact, to my mind, mas marami pa ako siguro libel cases ngayon than Manila Bulletin. No? Kasi wala naman atang libel cases na fina-file. And ako naman, even when I was an official of the... Even now, alam nyo yan, we have been together in governance. Marami akong nakasama rin sa inyong mga reporters. I have never filed a single case against any reporter, against anyone. Kasi ang thinking ko, public official kami. And open field kami. Open playing field, and we're subject to criticism. Normal naman yan sa isang public official. In fact, yung iba nagmumura pa, diba? Nagsasalita ng masama sa'yo. Hindi ko yung pinapansin. Yung case started from the ayuda. Kasi, in fact, hindi na nga ako nagsasalita about it eh. One of the decisions the decision to run was based on one of these issues. Ang ginawa nila, may PO, 400 million pesos. Yung 400 million pesos, nagkaroon lang siya ng isang cost price of the whole bag. Walang unit cost, ha? Dapat may unit cost ang mga purchase orders. Ang total niya is 1,149. Noong chinek namin, 630 pesos. And it's easy to check. Hindi naman to rocket science. Pumunta ka ng grocery store, pumunta ka ng palengke. So ang nawawalang pera is 190 million pesos. The other case was the case, yeah, laki, 400 million. The other case was the case of Joy Clement Mercado, an employee of City Hall. Sabi naman niya, 350 million, may purchase order din sila nakita. Ang cost ng buo is 840 pesos. Noong chinek nila, ang cost is 400 pesos, 450 or 400 pesos. So nawawala is about 160 70 million pesos. Can you imagine in the whole pandemic, ang binili ng city totals about 4 billion pesos. So kung medyo kalahati yan, that's about 1.8 to 2 billion, hindi naman dapat. I mean, di ba? Ano tayo eh, nasa pandemic, maraming hirap, maraming gutom. They could have used the money for more ayuda or for supporting many people in terms of kabuhayan, transportation, yung mga tricycle, walang kinikita, yung mga jeepney, talagang hirap. So we were saying na bakit ganito yung nangyari. On the one hand, nagkaroon ng rally si BBM. Nagsalita kami doon. Tapos sabi ko, nagsalita si Bingbong Crisologo. Sabi niya, susunod nating mayor, masipag, magaling, subok. Eh, ginawa nga nila yung video, pinalitan nila, nakalagay, susunod nating mayor, magaling, masipag, support. O, hindi naman ako nagalit, wala naman akong finail. Di ba? Kasi, I mean, understand, it's part of the game. They can say this thing. Sabi ko nga sa mga constituents ko, kahit na utawagin niyo akong support, wala kayong marinig sa akin at hindi ako magpa-file laban sa inyo.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mama Belle. We have Alyssa to ask the next set of questions.
Hi, sir. You have come out with allegations of wrongdoings in Quezon City Hall. Moving forward, if you are elected mayor, what do you plan to do about it?
Well, number one, these cases were not filed by me. These cases were filed by Task Force Kasana, an anti-corruption group in Davao, at saka yung isa pa is Clement Joy Mercado. So, syempre, moving forward, again, you have to unify the city, first and foremost. And when I speak of unification, it's not so much about magkakaibigan kayo, it's not so much about joining one party. We need to continuously fight the pandemic, yung COVID. When I say we need to unite, syempre yung ibang barangay officials are not for me. I understand that. Under the barangay officials, you have the BERT, the Barangay Health Emergency Response Team. And I think they need recognition. Ito yung mga frontliners sa community. Hindi alam to na marami. In fact, I filed the resolution already recognizing their contribution to the fight. Dahil yung mga frontliners, karamihan, syempre ang image or ang perception is the doctors, the nurses, the ones in the hospitals. Pero dun sa amin, sa mga barangay, ito yung humaharap, nagtitest, nagbibigay ng ayuda. Many of them have died. Many of them have gotten sick of COVID. Ito yung mga nagdadrive ng ambulansya, naghihintay for so many hours, naghatid. So we need to unite and we need to work together para to continuously fight the pandemic. Number two, we need to implement the necessary programs that we need to implement as I have promised and part of the things that we want to do for Quezon City. Siyempre, ang problema ko nang naman is when I sit, let's say assuming, God willing, I win, ang pondo na kakaharapin ko is the funds that they approved for this year. So I would work with that. Titingnan ko kung ano yung magagawa pa namin. You have the problem of education. We have to do the face-to-face na, di ba? Kailangan naming ayusin yan. Programa ng pangkabuhayan. They have that in their programs now and I hope to continue with that. But in a different way. Iba yung scheme na gagawin namin. But we have to continue with that dahil maraming walang trabaho. We have to help the businesses. Kailangan din yung mga negosyante, yung mga pag-approval ng business permits. Kung kailangan namin ibabayang taxes, we will do that. In fact, we have already spoken about bringing it down 5-10%. Definitely, we will not raise real property taxes. Kasi ang nakalagay sa ordinance, suspension up to December 2022. We do not need it now. Kawawa ang mga tao ngayon. Marami nga hindi nakakapagbayad dahil wala namang kinita no, for this year. So, yan kailangan din namin address. So, basically, it's really, working together. Yung transition team, we have to work together. I will not stop. Yung iba, di ba, magbabaksyon ako? Hindi. I will continuously work on what we have to do and hit the ground running. More than ever, I think yung ating bansa, we are confronted with a problem like the ones that were confronted by our predecessors ng World War II. Talagang bagsak, global economies are, the respective economies are all down. So we have, me in Quezon City, we have to address that. But more than what they confronted in the past is meron pa rin tayong kinoconfront na pandemic. May mga sakit ngayon. So you just can't do things that you have to do. Like for example, dati, di ba, build. Okay, build. But ano yung gagawin natin in the build program? Kailangan tayo ng isolation centers pa rin. Health centers pa rin. we have to build dialysis centers. Kasi yung mga walang COVID, hindi naman nakapunta rin sa ospital. Magpa-dialysis because the probability of catching COVID is still there. So these are the things na iba lang yung thrust, but we have to continue doing the programs to invigorate the economy and to confront COVID.
How is your leadership style different from the incumbent mayor?
Well, for one, hindi naman ako mainitin ng ulo, no? Hindi naman ako nagagalit. And some of you have seen me before in the past in the different departments. Number two, I'm always open to the media. Kahit noon na they want to ask me about something, policy, I'm open to that. And I think that's also one. Number three, I think, is yung, you know, Quezon City is a big city. Hindi kaya ng mayor yan. I think one of the things that they're saying or talking about is masyadong yung city leadership ngayon is composed of two families, the Limorongs and the Melmontes. And parang hindi sila nakipag-usap sa lahat. I think it's important that in first running the city, that you have to talk with everyone. Barangay officials. Alam mo sa amin, pag nagbigay ng ayuda yung city, hindi pwedeng ibigay ng barangay. Kailangan yung barangay coordinator ng city ang magbibigay. Which I think is wrong. Because you already have the barangay and they have people. Kaya nga nagka-problema kami sa SAP, yung distribution ng social amelioration program, because they want the treasurer's office of the city to be the ones giving it. Ako hindi ganun eh. Basta barangay official ka, kapitan ka, ilan yung accredited, ito yung funds, i-accept mo yan, ipa-accept mo yan and make sure that it's received by the people, and then you give it to me and you make a report. Because pag barangay official ka, ayoko magpila-pila eh. Ang gusto ko ibigay mo, bahay-bahay. Kung kaya mong ibigay ng GCash, walang face-to-face, then it's better. Because, you know, in the end, it's really managing everyone and managing the city. And lastly, last but not the least, I listen. Again, it's a big city. Hindi naman ako pinakamagaling, hindi ako pinakamatalino. And a lot of people have ideas. And many people on the ground know better what's happening on the ground. And you have to listen to them.
We know that you and your teammate running for Vice Mayor Winnie Castelo are under the unit team of BBM and Sara Duterte. What have you learned from them that you want to implement once the campaign starts in Quezon City?
You're talking of, okay, in terms of governance, syempre yung call ni BBM of pagkakaisa is very critical. I think it has affected not only us, but many candidates na, alam mo yung personal na tirahan na wala eh. Of course, issues can still continue. Kung may mga issues kayo, policy questions, okay yan. But I think medyo na downgrade because a lot of people are saying, wow, si BBM is going up because, you know, hindi siya tumitira, wala siyang masamang salita sa mga kandidato. It's always been a question of policy, question of what he wants to do. So, yun, very, very critical. Number two, syempre dapat alam mo yung issues. Hindi ka naman pwedeng nambobola, hindi naman pwedeng motherhood statements. You really need to know the issues on the ground, the things that you are confronted with, and the steps you have to take para ma-resolve itong mga bagay. Now, in terms of implementation, kami ni Winnie Castelo, talagang maganda yung aming chemistry. Marami kaming paniniwala na pareho. Winnie Castelo is known in his district as the Hari ng Pabay and Palupa. And I have always been also, that was why I was appointed Secretary of Housing when after Congress, immediately yun ang appointment ko, because I have been doing a lot of programs for housing in the city. Number two is talagang, as I've said, may mga bagay na hindi ko kaya. So Winnie and I are cooperating and coordinating on how things should be done now in the campaign and also in terms of governance. Kunyari, nagkaroon kami ng, nakita namin nung tumataas na yung Omicron virus, usap kagad kami, sabi namin, kailangan natin itong address, walang gamot yung mga tao, and yung face mask problema, alcohol problema. So immediately, order kami, COVID kits, vitamins, pinamimigay namin in a small way. We hope that we're able to help confront the problem of COVID. And syempre, yung leadership style ni Winnie and ako, nung I was in Congress before and now Winnie has been councilor and congressman, parati kaming nasa baba. Parati kaming umiikot. Parati naming inaalam ano yung problema na dapat naming ayusin sa ilalim. Kasi maraming problema na pumunta ka sa isang lugar, nakita mo all of a sudden, wow, bakit ganito? Ang dami pa rin mga pathwalks na putikan, marami pa rin mga yung maliliit na bagay na hindi na-addressed. In one area, wala pa rin silang tubig, wala pa rin silang kuryente. So these are the things that, you know, as a mayor or as a vice mayor, you really need to know the problems immediately confronted. There are big problems, strategic solutions like education, hospitalization, but there are small problems like the ones that I've been talking about. Walang may malnutrition sa daycare center, mga pathwalks na mga maputik, walang kuryente, walang tubig. Nung nagkaroon tayo ng yung ating program sa schooling, marami walang wifi, marami walang cell data. So these are the things that you have to address immediately, because if you don't, then kawawa yung mga estudyante na mahihirap ng Quezon City.
Thank you, Alyssa. Thank you, sir. We actually have a few more questions. Sige, water break.
Yes.
So, Sir Mike, we also have invited our social media followers,
yes,
to send in some questions. So we have Lance from social media team. We'll read some of the friendly and not so friendly questions. We hope you're ready.
Yes.
Thank you, Ms. Jane, and good morning, Sir Mike.
Morning, Lance.
First question is from Facebook follower Katie Ocampo. What can you say about the allegations about the black propaganda that your campaign is running on social media against the incumbent Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte?
The black propaganda that your campaign is running on Joy Belmonte. Okay, I have no black propaganda against Joy Belmonte. In fact, the issues that I said this morning are issues, not black propaganda, based on purchase orders, based on official documents of the city, no? In fact, I have confronted them many times. I wrote a letter. Asa na yung documents dito? We wrote the Commission on Audit about it. Na asa na yung documents dito? I filed the resolution in Congress to investigate. Pero nagulat na lang ako, 2 weeks after, nakita ko si Speaker Lord Velasco, tinataas yung kamay ni Joy Belmonte. So sabi ko, wala na to. Hindi na to matutuloy tong hearing na to. So I have never spoken of black propaganda. And in fact, if Joy Belmonte wants to reply, wants to discuss it, hindi na yung debating palengke, ha? She wants to, you know, in a cordial manner, reply and respond to these issues, I'm most willing to discuss it with her. If there are things coming out in social media, I think these are things coming out from people. They also hit me, they hit Joy. TikTok, nakikita ko rin, maraming mga lumalabas. It's okay, no? I mean, it's part of the game. And it's part of the playing field that we're in.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Facebook follower Joel Buen Ramos. Last December 24, Quezon City was declared as the richest city in the Philippines, overtaking Makati for 3 years. After 3 years, what economic programs will your administration implement to sustain this?
Okay, I want to clarify that there are two issues here. Yung richest city kasi is based on assets, income, so on and so forth. But it is uncontested that Quezon City has the biggest budget. Quezon City in last year, ang budget niya is about 30 billion. 30 billion pesos. Makati is only 18 billion. Si Manila is 18 billion. Ngayon nga, nagtaas nga si Mayor Isko eh. I think nag-increase lang ang budget. But let's say, para lang apples to apples, 18 billion. Taguig is 12 billion. So talagang uncontested, pinakamayaman ng Quezon City. So how do we sustain that economic growth? Okay, on that side of the yung question ng development ng Quezon City, importante, number one, yung mga businesses. Tanggalin yung corruption sa business permits. Tanggalin yung corruption sa pag-apply nila, sa delay. You know, in many cities, I mentioned even Marikina, yung mga minention ko kasama na yung Marikina, mag-apply ka na Monday, Wednesday makukuha mo na yung permit mo. Sa Quezon City, mag-apply ka na Monday ng January, Wednesday ng March makukuha mo na yung permit mo. Ang tagal talaga. Now, ano yung sinasabi lang isang delay? Bureau of Fire, di ba? Which is outside of our purview of the city. Pero madaling solusyonan yan eh. In Caloocan, it was as simple as you can already operate subject to the final submission of the Bureau of Fire. So walang pressure. In fact, ang pressure, the burden now was transferred to the Bureau of Fire kasi may ARTA sila. 15 days you have to release the permit. Number two, pwede ko naman kunin eh, lahat ng applications. And I'll be the one applying to the Bureau of Fire. 1,000 applications, kaysa ko apply. No one should be talking to the Bureau of Fire. Ako yan. Para wala silang madanasan na mga corruption. Ang problema ng Quezon City, iba yung computerization ng treasury, ng assessor, ng permitting system. Computerized, pero iba-iba. Pag ginawa ditong assessment ay ganito, kunyari, 1,000, pupunta sa treasury, pwedeng gawing 800. So there's already discretion, which is also results to corruption. So we need to entice our businessmen to continue to stay in Quezon City and for the others to invest. Number two, kailangan namin ayusin yung business tax. You know, in Taguig, they did not raise the taxes because they wanted to be competitive against Makati. Kami ang kalaban namin, Pasig, Bantaluyong, of course, Makati also, and Manila. So kailangan namin ayusin yung taxes namin na dito na kayo mag-invest. Number three, yung land use program. Ang nangyari sa amin, puro special use. Alam nyo, residente, biglang mamaya, pag gising mo lang, may punanarya sa tabi mo. Diba? Or commercial area. Biglang maglalagay silang industrial. Hindi dapat ganun. Dapat i-respect yung land use program at wala ding corruption. Kung ano yan, pag-apply, approve. Yung business permit, anong sinasabi ng mga negosyante ngayon? Alam mo, gumawa sila ng isang scheme, which I think is reasonable, pero not at this time. Kunyari, gumawa sila, vendor ka. Whether you sell or not, kasi di ba dapat ang business taxes based on gross income. Ngayon, kung mababa ang gross income mo, meron silang minimum floor na magbayad ka, 20,000 a year. Paano naman tayo dumaan ng COVID? Talagang maraming zero. So dapat hindi yan parusahan. So that's on the one hand. The second thing that you have to do is that Quezon City is the most populous city. Ang problema namin, ang graduates namin 20%. 18% college graduates, 2% ang technical vocational. So can you imagine, paano mag-invest ang negosyante kung ang mga tao nila, I mean, wala ka ma-hire sa Quezon City. So we need to educate our people to jive with the requirements of business. Pumunta ka ng Quezon City, restaurant na lang ha, simpleng-simple. Tanungin mo, saan kayo nakatira? Bulacan. Karamihan. When you can, in fact, you can train them. Give them the proper skills to help support the businesses in Quezon City. Now, moving forward, economic program na to ha, ano ang dapat direksyon ng mayor? And I'm, not only me, if ako pala rin, well and good. Pero for the city officials now, kailangan tingnan nila yung development ng Bulacan Airport. In 3 to 5 years, the entry point now to Metro Manila will be Quezon City. Dapat i-develop na namin yan. Trinoma is already there. It's developing. Yung Quezon Avenue, kailangan namin i-develop. Yung Commonwealth, kailangan namin i-develop. East Avenue. Yung EDSA na Quezon City side, kailangan namin i-develop. Anong ibig kong sabihin? Pag pumunta ka ng Quezon City ngayon, ang dilim. Magpunta ka ng Manila, Intramuros. Diba? Ang liwanag, ang gaganda ngayon ng mga street sign nyo. Pagpasok nyo ng Quezon City, nakakatakot na. Diba? Talagang pag pumunta kang Quezon Avenue, dalawa lang nakikita mo. Kundi nightclub, punenaria. Diba? Kailangan naman i-develop yan. Gandahan mo yung sidewalk, gandahan mo yung ilaw. Kailangan lumiwanag ang Quezon City to entice the businesses to come here. Ang dami pa namin lupa for industrial development. So, you know, again, anong kailangan yung workers? Anong kailangan yung tax incentive to ensure that you invest in Quezon City? Nakakalungkot because many businesses in Quezon City have their main offices now in Cainta, have their main offices in Marikina, have their main offices in Bulacan. I do not want that. I want them to stay in Quezon City. I want them to invest and to expand in Quezon City. We will provide them the necessary support. Because in return, ito naman mga negosyanteng to will be the ones creating jobs and will be paying the taxes in Quezon City.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. The third question is from our Twitter follower, Ian Granada. Ano po ang sasabihin nyo sa mga taga Quezon City na nawala ng trabaho sa pagsang-ayon nyo sa pagsara ng ABS-CBN? Bakit kanila dapat iboto?
Thank you for that question. Alam niyo itong ABS-CBN has been a continuing continuing factor in this campaign. Gusto ko lang ulinawin that when I decided on the ABS-CBN issue, and I was very active in the hearings, it was born out of my duty as congressman of not only of anak kalusugan of my party list, but as a member of Congress. Because, una po, iyan po'y application for a franchise. And on the base of that, may conditions yan. May batas yan. May mga governing laws. And in fact, yung even the Constitution governs yung aming desisyon. And ako parati kong sinasabi, di ba, yung nakita kong problema, una yung taxes. Maraming problema. And, I mean, GMA against ABS-CBN, at least every year, short yung ABS ng 1 billion a year. Number two, yung naging concern na pinag-usapan are the workers. Maraming problema and maraming cases sa Supreme Court and we were able to discuss it. In fact, nagpapasalamat nga si Weng Hidalgo dahil when we took up the case in Congress, siguro a month after, na-hire na siya ulit as a permanent employee of ABS-CBN. But after that, 2-3 months after, nagkaroon ng Supreme Court decision, yung mga natanggal na trabador, nabayaran sila. Nanalo sila sa Supreme Court. Sila, anong pangalan niya? Si Journalee, the president of the ABS-CBN Employees Association. The third issue was the PDRs. When we mentioned that, naging case yan, and then GMA 7 said, we will now start selling our PDRs because they saw what transpired in Congress. And I guess it is a recognition that there was a mistake. Okay. Having said that, meron ba akong natanggap dun sa nangyaring yun? Meron bang additional budget? Meron bang promotion sa position? Hindi nga eh. After 2 months, natanggal pa nga ako eh, as chairman of the Committee on Public Accounts. So it was just a matter of duty. It was never personal. Now, having said that, yung kalabang ko, yung pamilya nila, si Speaker Sonny Belmonte was the speaker in 2014. In-apply na yung ABS-CBN franchise. Bakit hindi nila pinag-usapan at that time? They had 2 years to finish that franchise. Kami, when we were discussing the ABS-CBN franchise, tapos na. So pressured na kami, wala na. Nag-lapse na yung franchise and we were pressured to discuss a lapse franchise in Congress. Ngayon, 2014 yun din, 2014, nagkaroon na ng application ng ABS-CBN. You know, in many government agencies, maraming franchisees, maraming applicants. Ayun na. Maraming applicants. And hindi po ba, pagka may ganong problema, dapat doon pa lamang years before, dinidiscuss ano yung problems. For example, nagkaroon ng problema sa taxes. Then they could have discussed it. And they could have already remedied the situation. Another thing is, nung nagdi-discuss na kami, and ito nga madalas kong sabihin eh, di ba dapat nagsalita na lang sana nung nagdi-discuss na, if it's a problem, the tax is an issue, then can you put it as part of the provision that you approve it and we will comply with the conditions of Congress that those payments will be complied with, will be paid. Pero hindi eh. It was a question of right or wrong, black and white, na hindi. Wala kami ginawang mali. So, you know, can you imagine that we were subjected to that? So again, ang sagot ko po dyan is, ako po, ginawa ko yung trabaho ko, and that now, when you choose the mayor of Quezon City, you have to choose a different kind of animal. Iba pong trabaho. Hindi na po yan policy. It's a question of management. Mamanage namin yung ating syudad, ang pondo ng syudad. Imamanage namin yung COVID, yung pandemya, na bumaba at walang magkasakit. Na hindi katulad ngayon, no? We have the highest number of COVID positive and we have the highest number of deaths. Imamanage namin yung development ng city. Imamanage namin yung educational scholarship programs ng city. You mentioned earlier the economic programs. Imamanage po namin yan. If you are happy with the current administration, at yung ginagawa nila, I'm fine with that. But if you want change, if you want these things addressed, then I'm offering myself to be part of that leadership in the future.
Thank you, sir. Moving on, the next question is from a Facebook follower who doesn't want to be named. Unti-unti nang bumabalik sa normal ang kalakaran sa Quezon City at kaakibat nito ang pagbalik ng malalang congestion sa mga kalsada. May aksyon bang maaasahan mula sa inyo ang mga taga Quezon City tungkol sa traffic?
Yes. In fact, ito yung beauty Okay, first is yung Metro Manila, yung traffic sa Metro Manila problem. Pero yung beauty na magkasama kayo ng presidente, malaking bagay. As we are talking now, chinek ko na sa NEDA. May pending na application for MRT 11. Ito yung sa Quirino Highway. Isa yan sa pinaka-traffic na lugar sa amin lugar. So ito, immediately, when you know the president wins and I'm given a chance, aayusin ko agad yan so that it will be a priority. Yung MRT 7 sa Commonwealth, nandyan na, ginagawa na. Kailangan namin gawin ulit yung traffic, for example, sa Ateneo. Kailangan namin yung widening sa White Plains and other areas na kailangan ng major infrastructure developments. Alam nyo, yung Skyway na dumudugtong ng Quezon Avenue going down to the south, ginawa pa nga yun ng San Miguel eh. Initiative ng private corporation. We have to look into Quezon City, paano namin aayusin yung daloy ng trafiko. Ano yung major infrastructure programs na kailangan na namin gawin? So I mentioned about 2-3 programs like yung MRT 11 sa Quirino, yung pag-aayos dito sa Katipunan, yung traffic doon, yung pag-aayos sa, of course, Mindanao Avenue is also part of that area na kailangan namin ayusin. So these are the things that you have to do and you need the support of a president. Yung ginawa ng Quezon City ngayon, may ginawa silang no contact apprehension policy. Mukhang sinuspend nga nila eh, kasi I've been talking against it. Ang ginawa nila, may applicant, negosyante. Sabi ng negosyante, oh, maglalagay ako ng camera sa Quezon City. My cost. Pero, pagka nang huli tayo, yung bayad nila sa penalty, hati tayo. Okay. Pero masama, in-increase nila. From 500 pesos, ginawa lang 2,000 to 3,000 pesos. In fact, yung violation of traffic signs, 3,000 pesos. Feeling ko naman, mali naman yan. Not in this pandemic, okay yan. Ako, I will put the same cameras, I will implement the same, have it privately managed, pero hindi nila popondohan, ha? Pondo ng Quezon City, so that meron tayo talagang, kumbaga, monitoring ng traffic, meron tayong oversight ng traffic, but I will not increase the penalties on traffic. So that's part of the program that we will do to address the traffic of Quezon City.
Thank you, sir. Next is from Katrina Valenzuela from our Twitter page. Her question is, nung nakaraan lang, may isinagawang commitment ceremony sa Quezon City para sa mga LGBTQ couples. Kayo po, may plano po ba kayo para sa LGBT community? Paano nyo po gagawing inclusive at discrimination-free ang Quezon City?
Alam mo, I am a co-author of the SOGI Bill in Congress. Yung SOGI Bill, ang sinasabi niya doon, is iwasan natin yung diskriminasyon, pang-ape, pagyurak sa karapatan ng mga LGBT. And I agree with that. Number two, I have a daughter who is an LGBT. In fact, I guess from dahil doon, it became somehow nag-viral and people already talking to me, people are asking me and all these things. Okay yan sa akin. I will support them. The programs for education, programs for pangkabuhayan, kailangan silang tulungan. And very, ano yan eh, yung LGBT community ng Quezon City, masisipag, magagaling. No? And you just need to support them para ma-unleash yung mga potential nila. I do not know kung may particular programs na gusto sila for them. In fact, nung nagkaroon ng problem kami nung COVID, sila pa ngayon tumutulong eh. So I guess you support them, but they will also help the communities para sa mga pagtulong sa mga ayuda. Ang hindi ko gusto sa ginawa ni Joy, and I'm sorry for saying this, nag-officiate siya ng kasal, si Mayor Joy, ng LGBT. Ako naman, alam mo, I recognize yung civil partnership. Nasa batas naman yan. And if it would be easier for them to get that, tama naman yan. Kasi nga naman, magsasama kayo 40 years. Kayo yung mag-asawa. Yung naipon nyo, wala kang karapatan sa isa't isa. Kahit na nga ma-hospital yung isa, kung ano yung gagawin ng medical, let's say, medical undertaking, walang right yung partner to sign. No, it's only the family. So ako, I recognize that. Pero to go to the point na magpakasal, na ipapakasal niya, eh medyo doon hindi kami nag-agree ni Mayor Joy. Medyo tingin ko doon, lumagpas naman siya doon sa pinapayagan ng batas.
We are down to our last question from social media, sir. Our reader from Facebook who remains to be anonymous wants to know, Base sa datos ng PSA, aabot ng 60,000 ang out-of-school youth sa Quezon City noong 2016. Sa kasagsagan ng pandemya, lalong dumami ang bilang na ito. Ano ang iyong unang gagawin kapag naupo bilang alkalde para matugunan ito?
Okay, kailangan natin unang-una sa lahat, right after, again, if I'm given a chance, God willing, makita natin yung social problems. Maraming mga may problema sa Quezon City na, alam mo, yung mga kailangan ng saklay, kailangan ng wheelchair, yung may mga PWD na anak, and so on and so forth. So, kailangan ko malaman ano yung basis ng pagiging out-of-school youth nila. Yan ba talaga ay wala nang magulang, wala nang silang bahay, wala nang silang tinitirang pamilya. So, we have to address that. But anyway, I want to address because he mentioned yung Philippine Statistics Authority. In 2018, ang adult population ng Quezon City, as I've mentioned, 20% lang ang graduates. For every 100 students na papasok, 20 lang ang graduate. Ang gagawin ko sa Quezon City, number one, ayusin ko immediately yung daycare centers. Kasi sa amin, hindi enough ang daycare centers. And we have to start with education from the youngest age, from yung pinakabatang edad nila, na kailangan mo silang tulungan. So we need to have enough daycare centers and we need to give them support. I'll tie up with NGOs, with foundations, para dun sa malnutrition program. Kasi marami pa rin malnourished sa mga estudyante na Quezon City. I mentioned kanina yung Makati, Manila, Taguig, even Caloocan. Alam mo, sa kanila, libre na yung sapatos, libre yung uniforme, libre yung gamit sa eskwelahan ng mga estudyante. We are the richest city. Again, as I've mentioned, we have the biggest budget. And yet, sa Quezon City, hindi ganun. Sabi lang, hindi, ang daming estudyante ng Quezon City. No. Ang estudyante ng Quezon City is 430,000 based on PSA data. At yun, kinumpute ko na hindi ka abot ng 1 billion. No? Maybe more than 500 million. You will give them enough support in terms of shoes, supplies, and uniforms. Bakit natin kailangan yan? Because it gives them dignity. It gives them confidence. Tapos nabubuo yung pangarap nila na they want to graduate. Of course, the next step is, ano bang gusto nyo sa college? Gusto nyo ba 4-year course? Si President Duterte already gave us yung free college education. But many people do not know this. Not all can enter state colleges and universities. Kasi may entrance exams. So maraming mga estudyante na hindi naman top 100, top 200 ng kanilang schools, pero masipag, no? May pangarap. Gusto talaga niyan magtapos. Those are the ones we need to support. So ang gusto kong gawin, alam mong scholarship ngayon, 4,000 a sem ang binibigay, 8,000 a year. Hindi talaga kasya. So gusto kong tulong sa kanila, 1,000 a month, a week, 4,000 a month, 50,000 a year, more or less, ang support. So that, if you give 50,000 students 50,000 pesos, that's only 2.5 billion. Not even 10% of our total budget. Alam niyo ho yung education fund namin, yung binabayaran nyo ng SAF, I don't know if you're, some of you are from Quezon City, may binabayaran kayo na 1% for education. It's for all cities. Ang budget ng Quezon City, 3 billion every year. So, let's move towards yung ito nga education. So, I'm sure, pag upo ko, maraming mga hindi na nag-aaral, maraming mga gusto pa mag-aaral, maraming nagtatrabaho na. I have already spoken, we have about 140 technical vocational schools in Quezon City. So gusto mo mag-aral 6 months electronics, 1 year computer programming, gusto mo mag-BPO, I'll support you. Bukod sa libre tuition fee, bibigyan kitang baon. Mag-aral ka, magtapos ka. Because later on, pag nagtapos naman yan, it will redound to the benefit of Quezon City. So that's our general direction para matulungan namin yung mga kabataan sa aming lungsod.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Lance. Thank you to all our social media followers for sending those interesting questions. But Sir Mike, we have a few more questions, a little bit more personal and light.
Sure. Huwag lang masyadong personal. May si Rocky nasasagot ng iba pag masyadong
personal. Naka-standby po dito sa likod. What plans do you have in mind when it comes to tourism? I know the pandemic has stopped a lot of projects and plans. But what do you plan to do immediately to spur tourism development?
Okay, number one, kailangan natin ayusin yung Quezon Memorial Circle. Diba? Alam mo, sa ibang bansa, pag pumunta ka sa Lincoln Memorial, Washington Memorial, even in Asian countries, pag nakita mo talagang memorial. Ang nangyari sa Quezon Memorial Circle, parang Changi eh. Tapos may taniman ng petsay ata kung ano yung tinatanim doon. No, I mean, I have nothing against yung mga magtanim tayo, no? But it has to be a memorial. You know, when you go there, may fountain, it's nice, maliwanag. Ngayon, pagtingin mo, ang dumi. Umikot kayong circle, ang dumi-dumi. So we need to fix that. We need to address the Quezon City Memorial Circle. Yung Centennial dyan, may convention center, I think it's already there. I spoke with itong, ano, meron kayong hotel ngayon bago, yung Rizal Park Hotel. You know, it's a heritage hotel. Sabi ko, wow, ang ganda nito. I hope we can do that. Jerry Acosar is from Quezon City. Siya yung nagtayo ng Las Casas Acosar, no? So, kailangan namin i-develop to, pagandahin talaga. Na pag pumunta ka, magagandahan ka sa Quezon City Memorial Circle. Of course, dito rin nag-start sa amin ang kaya nga malayang Quezon City. Diba? Diyan sa Pugadlawin, sa kaya may Pugadlawin dahil yung puno may Pugadlawin, nagbimiting sila sa lugar ni Tandansora. We have to fix that area. Doon nagsimula yung sigaw sa Apolonio Samson, na dyan yung, diba, yung pinunit yung mga sedula. Kailangan namin i-restore yung lugar na yan. Pero, sa akin kasi, ang Quezon City is benefited by two forest areas. Kami lang ang may gubat sa buong Metro Manila. Yung Parks and Wildlife at saka yung Lamesa Eco Dam. Yung Parks and Wildlife, parang naging ano eh, naging motel. Kasi bayad sa 10 piso, may date sila, ikot na sila doon. We want to make this the Singapore Zoo of the Philippines. Di ba? Na ang Singapore Zoo malaki, 160 hectares. Ito 26 lang eh. But we can make it a small night zoo in Quezon City. Yung Lamesa Eco Dam, again, in relation to ABS-CBN, kausap ko yung mga tao doon. I told them kasi natanggal sila because of the Bantay Kalikasan. Sabi ko, no, hintayin nyo lang, pag-upo ko, I will hire you, I will partner with the foundations. Gusto ko talaga may hotel area, nagbabike sila. Kasi ngayon naman may biking na, may mga ikutan na. Pero gusto ko talaga yung ma-develop siya ng maganda-maganda as a tourism site of Quezon City. Number three, kami ang lechon capital of the Philippines, La Loma. Diba? Kailangan pagandahin natin yan. Magkaroon ng magandang parking, tuntul may mga tao, ayusin natin yan. Yung Chinatown namin hindi pa develop. So we have to develop also that. Kasi may Chinatown kami, connecting to the Chinatown of Manila. So, kausap ko na rin sila doon. Sabi ko, gawin natin talagang Chinatown to. We are the automotive center of the Philippines, Banawi. So kailangan din natin ayusin yung lugar na yan. So these are the things that we need to develop. Yung Amoranto, again, kasi Philippine, ano to? Nasa PSC siya eh, Philippine Sports Authority ba? Ay, sorry. Di ba, nandun siya. Gusto ko naman i-develop yan as a center of, parang kung meron kayong Rizal Memorial dito, sports development program, i-develop talaga namin yan. Kung nakita nyo nung nag-rally doon sa Amoranto, hindi maganda na yung stadium eh. I want to develop it. I want it to be the center of sports in Quezon City and hopefully in Metro Manila.
Thank you, sir. Exciting projects ahead. Yeah, dami. Sir, we have two more questions. Nabanggit mo po, ikaw rin po ay isang tatay.
Oh, yes,
so, how are you able to balance being a parent and a politician, especially in this very hectic campaign season?
Yes. Okay, besides my five-year-old, yung youngest ko ngayon is turning 20. Okay, she's already studying abroad. So, for the longest time naman, lahat ng mag-anak ko magkakasunod yun eh. 25, 23, tapos 22, 20. So, magkakasunod tong apat. And even when I was in government before, I really took time. Siguro ngayon ko lang makakwento, no? You know, when I was secretary, di ba parating meron kaming office, pero meron kaming sarili naming kwarto. Nangyari sa mga kwarto ko, playground. Totoo yan. In fact, there was a time I was meeting with an ambassador, the ambassador of Canada. So, nagbi-meeting kami, and you know, we were giving each other our credentials, nag-uusap kami, so, Your Excellency, blah, blah. Narinig ko may mga nagbibisikleta, nagsisigawan. Yung maliliit naman na bike, yung bike na pambata. So, nagtitext ako sa wife ko na nakakayanan dito yung ambassador, narinig. Sigawan pa rin na sigawan. Siguro, hindi nakita yung wife ko. So, I had to excuse myself. I went to the room, sabi ko, please, yung mga bata, patahimikin nyo naman. Kasi nga, nagbabike, nagsisigaw, nag-ahabulan. So, you know, when I went back to the ambassador, natatawa rin siya. Alam din niya eh, narinig naman niya yung mga bata. Siguro, hindi lang niya sa kumigo po. So, I always gave my time to my children. I don't think anyone would complain na one call, tawag agad ako. Ano yan? Anong problema? One meeting. Lahat ng PTA, inattendan ko. In fact, after the 2010, yung tapos na yung stint ko in government, so I nag-private ako ng 12 years, na-elect pa akong PTA. Natatawa nga ako kasi, hindi naman ako president eh. Nakalagay doon president, ganyan. Babae yung presidente namin sa Ateneo. Nakalagay pa rin ako secretary. Secretary Mike Defensor. Tapos, sabi ng PTA president, Mike, sabi niya, gawa ka na nung minutes ng gagawin. Sabi ko, nagpalaro lang tayo ah. Hindi, gawin mo pa rin yung minutes, nagpalaro tayo. So, kung gagawin ko pa rin yung minutes na yun, sabi ko, ano ba nangyari sa buhay ko dati-dati? Gobyerno yung pinapatakbo, ngayon yung minutes ng everything. So, you know, now my 5-year-old, siyempre ngayon nagtatampo ng kaunti. Totoo yan ha, because I'm always with her. Pero sinabi ko naman, anak, you know, when yung pagmamaba na yung COVID, you can go with me, we can go around. And I also want you to help, kasi yun naman yung training ko eh. I want them to see the problems, I want them to have also the, yung makita nila, ma-expose sila, na alam nila, na yung tatay nila, hindi lang yung, ayoko yung mag-isip sila na power, mayor, ganito, no. We're there to serve. We're there to help the people.
Thank you, sir. One more question. This month is Women's Month. So what are your plans for the women of QC? Will it be hard for you to convince them considering that you are running against a woman?
You know, looking at the service that we have, hindi naman din talaga. Hindi naman din talaga na because yung babae kalabang ko, the tendency is there. But yes, the inclination is more towards towards her. And ako naman, naintindihan ko naman yun, no? Ako, ang gusto ko lang sabihin, lalo tigit nitong pandemic, you know, more than ever, the woman now played a very key and vital role in this pandemic. Why? Una, anong kakainin natin? Si babae ang nag-aayos, paano kakainin? Pangalawa, maraming nawala ng trabaho. Si babae yung gumagawa ng paraan. Gawa tayong basahan, magtinda tayo sa kurinderya, magtinda tayo online. Pangatlo, yung babae rin ang nag-aayos nung paggamit ng tablet. O ikaw muna ngayon dahil klase mo. Pagkatapos niyan, ikaw naman ngayon. So they really played a vital role. And I'm sure they will play a very vital role in the future. Yung programang pangkabuhayan ko is a very direct and simple program. Kasi yung ginawa ng city, dole out. Kunyari, kung dinegosyo ka, bibigyan sa'yo 10,000. Okay. But again, I said, no. In order to manage the program well, and in order to make everyone responsible, you really need to have a corporation. Why a corporation? Because government cannot collect payment from private individuals. We can only collect fees. We can only collect payment in taxes. But we permits. But we cannot collect yung bayad. No? So you need a corporation to do that. So yung corporation ngayon, dun mo ilalagay yung pera. And I'm thinking 2-3 billion. In fact, even 5 billion. For this year, pautangin mo sila 20,000, 10,000. I think, you know, and then no interest, they pay 200 a month. Kasi bakit? Ang dami sa isang barangay, siguro almost, I would think, 60% nagtitinda ng gulay, nagtitinda ng karne. Umuutang yan sa Bombay. Yung Bombay, yung 20,000 ang binabayaran niya, 400 a day ang bayad niya sa Bombay. So can you imagine yung ginhawa niya na ito yung pera? If you pay early, may discount ka, 20%, 10%. But if you pay na based on your capability lang, 200 is very small. Basta magbayad ka. Once we have reached the level na malaki na yung collection, I will privatize the collection system. Para walang corruption, walang ano. And marami na ngayon digital eh, GCash na lang eh. Yung pagpaira mo sa kanila, bigay mo, at yung bayad na, GCash na lang din. I want Quezon City to become a major, marami sa amin gumagawa ng basahan, marami sa amin gumagawa ng mga ribbons, gumagawa ng kung ano ng products. So gusto ko magkaroon talaga kami ng ganitong support so that people outside of the formal work, outside of their the jobs of the men or maybe those going to offices and factories, yung informal sector namin, mapalakas din namin so that they can be supported in these times of crisis.
Thank you very much, Sir Mike Defensor, for your insightful responses and for accepting our invitation to be on our hot seat.
Again, thank you so much for the opportunity of having me here, for asking the hard questions. And again, as I've said, ako naman, I'm offering myself as an alternative to the current leadership of Quezon City. And what I'm offering is not only the programs of Quezon City, but hopefully, if we're able to get the presidency and the mayoralty leadership of Quezon City, we will be able to solve many problems in our city. Dadagdag ko lang naman konti ah. May hospital kasi kami tatlo. Maclan Bautista, Novaliches District Hospital, and Quezon City General Hospital. Pero Quezon City benefited din ng maraming public hospitals, Heart Center, Children's. Pero itong tatlong hospital namin, gusto ko talagang paayos. And you need the support of the President for this, including the Universal Healthcare Program under PhilHealth. Kasi ang pakiramdam ng mga taga Quezon City, pag pumasok sila sa hospital namin, paglabas sila sa St. Peter na sila papunta, kundi sa Loyola Memorial. So kailangan naming ayusin yung aming mga hospital. Simpleng lab test, simpleng mga facilities for CT scan, X-ray, we need to do that. Number two, and I'm sure you're from Quezon City, yung problem ng informal settlers. Tayo yung pinakamarami, 300,000 ang informal settler families in Quezon City. I hope yung panawagan ni Bongbong Marcos na pagbangon, Quezon City will be targeted as a major area because we have the biggest informal settlers in Metro Manila. How do we do it? Iba-iba yung approach. Number one is community mortgage program. May lupa ka, squatted, hindi mo na mapaalis, gusto mo na ibanta, we will support in terms of financing. Number two, yung aming mga lupa na gusto ko magkaroon ng batas, use of rack law. You know, in Singapore, pag nagbenta ng mga units, hindi naman kasama lupa eh. In Lee Kuan Yew, during his time, ang ginawa niya, 4 stories muna. Okay yan, 4 stories muna. But later on, nakita, oh, mayaman na Singapore, may pera na tayo, 10 stories, 20 stories. Mura na elevator, hindi katulad dati, 10 years, 20 years ago, mahalang elevator. Ngayon, kaya na natin. Pero wag isama yung lupa. So government can still own the land, but we are able to provide them ownership of the condominium unit. Pwede lang ibenta, pwede nilang i-loan, pwede nilang i-trade, no, yung units. Number three would really be developing sites for relocation. Maraming public land eh. At ang nasa ilog natin, yung mga danger zones, 50,000. We need to address that. Hindi pwedeng tuwing nalang bagyo, may namamatay. No? And then last but not the least, are some of the lands that you can already proclaim. Kasi marami naman lands dyan na matagal na nandun yung tao, like Tatalon, proclaimed na yan eh. Pero hindi nila maayos yung titling. So that we need to address. So again, thank you for this opportunity. These are just some of the basic programs that we need to do, and we have a lot of things to do in the future. Again, sama-sama ho, including the media, of course, Manila Bulletin, as a leading source of information of our country to help us in our development, not only of Quezon City, but the whole country. Maraming salamat po sa inyo.
That is our Hot Seat episode for today. We hope that you have learned something new about the candidate running for Quezon City's top job as mayor. We hope that this can help you make an informed decision about the upcoming elections. Dahil ang pagkakaroon ng matalinong boto ay isang responsibilidad ng bawat Pilipino. Please like and share this video and subscribe to all the Manila Bulletin social media accounts on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. Please use the hashtags MB Hot Seat Defensor, Matalinong Boto 2022,
and Magandang Bukas.
Till next time, I'm Jane King Sucheng and this is MB Hot Seat.